right, good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's meeting. We're going to have the invocation by Sergeant Gazara Hill, chaplain with Clayton County Police Department, and it will be followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. If you would, stand with me.
Let us pray. Our God and our Father, you said to let our moderations to be known unto you. We come this evening, God, because we know that you are a sovereign God and we need you. And we cannot get along without you. And God, you told me last night that when I come to pray, not to pray for anyone else but those who stand before me, and I ask you now to lead our leaders. Let us know, God, that it's you, God, who speaks through them. Cover them with your blood. Crown their heads with wisdom and knowledge and understanding. Let them know, God, that they cannot please everybody all the time, and that if they do your will, it'll be all right. And we ask you, God, to send peace in this house, for we know that your peace surpasses all understanding. And we ask you, Master, to let us know and keep us knowing, God, that there are somebody, husband or wife, son or daughter, and there are people just like us. Teach us, God, to respect whom you set in place. And God, I know, God, if we do your will, we'll hear those last words in the last days. Servant of God, well done. Thank you now. Thank you for our commissioners. And bless you, God, for blessing them. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please, let's silence our phones.
Good evening and welcome to the October 20th, 2015 regular business meeting. The first order of business is the adoption of the agenda. Does any member want to offer any amendments at this time?
Madam Clerk, we received a letter from Knight Homes. I think it says it was forwarded to you that they were going to withdraw their zoning request.
Yes, Commissioner Rooks, since the request was not to table it or to remove it from the agenda, I did not bring it forward at this time. But if that is your desire or the desire of the board to move forward with it, the board can do so.
Ms. Smith isn't here. Oh.
The zoning ordinance basically states that it must come forward. The Board of Commissioners do not have the authorization to reject a letter of withdrawal for an application.
We cannot reject it.
Cannot.
So I have to remove it from the agenda?
Yes.
Okay. Madam Clerk, I request that be removed.
Second.
Properly moved and second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. It's unanimous. Madam Clerk, I might ask for the HR director to bring forth a recommendation to hire for the chief operating officer's position for the board's consideration. Is there a second?
Second.
Probably moved second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Are there any further amendments?
Members of the board, Madam Clerk, I would ask that the board hold resolution number 267, resolution number 2015-267, and resolution number 2015-268, and item number 22, which is a zoning petition. Ellen Smith requests for a CUP until after tonight's executive session, which will be for real estate, personnel, and litigation.
And I'll place that in the form of a motion to hold those two items until after executive session. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Probably move the second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Are there any further amendments? May we have a motion to adopt the agenda with the approved amendments?
Is there a second?
Properly moved by Commissioner Edmondson, second by Commissioner Rooks. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous.
Approval of the October 6, 2015 regular business meeting minutes.
Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the minutes.
Is there a second? I'll second it. Properly moved and second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Abstain.
There's one abstention. He was in that last meeting, and four approvals.
Mr. Chairman, we would now have public comment. We do have citizens that have signed up to speak before the board. Citizens will be given 3-minute maximum time limit to speak before the Board of Commissioners. Please state your name and county of residency for the record. Speak clearly into the microphone, and speakers should be courteous, respectful, and not make any disparaging remarks or use abusive language when addressing the board.
All right, we're going to start with two that we left off from last meeting. Ms. Lisa Fleming. Is she here? Lisa Fleming. Candy Lang. Miss Candy Lang. Okay. Gail Bedingfield.
Good evening, Commissioners. Good evening, Mr. Chairman. My name is Gail Bedingfield, and I live in historic Rex Village. I'm one of Ms. Gregory's. She's my commissioner. I'm here tonight with two different hats to wear. I'd like to speak on two different things. The first one, I'd like to thank the Clayton County Police Department Explorers, the young youth that are with the police department. This past Saturday, we had our 5th annual Rex Village Community Neighborhood Yard Sale, and the Explorers came out and did a fantastic job talking to the youth in the neighborhood there. I'd also like to thank CCTV 23, Glenita Griffin and Lindsay DeLong. What a wonderful job they do for our county. It's amazing how far that channel has gone underneath their directorship. The reason we do the community activities that my husband and I do is because we like unity in our community, and it's a way for young people and the adults to get together and promote entrepreneurship there in our county. So we do that under the Rex Mill Step Up program. But I'm also co-captain of our historic Rex Village Neighborhood Watch program, and that represents about 30 families in the unincorporated area of Rex Village that are tax-paying families here in our community. In 1959, at the age of 6, my family moved into Clayton County. All of my schooling was in Clayton County schools, and I am a 1971 graduate of Forest Park Senior High. In 1975, my husband and I purchased the historic Rex Mill down in the village area. We also purchased another home, but we continue to live in Forest Park, and we moved to Rex permanently in 1984. So basically, out of my 62 years of life, most of them have been here in the Clayton County community. I've also been very active in my community throughout my adult life and will continue to do so. That being said, my roots are planted deeply here in Clayton County. And tonight I'm here in support of Chief Michael Register. I've had the privilege of knowing many of the officers that patrol our village area. We've been very lucky. They stop and talk to my husband and I. Every one of the officers that we've talked to talk about how well the morale is underneath Chief Register and how improved they feel like the command is under Chief Register. I'm asking you, the board, to keep Chief Register, as it would be very unsettling for our command to go back and forth and facilitate back and forth between two different men when we have a man that is very well qualified. In fact, I think we need to give Chief Register the opportunity to do the job that he is more than qualified to do. He's very well qualified. I've never seen anyone in Clayton County in the police department that has the qualities he has. So I'm urging you tonight, please, to start the groundwork to help us keep Clayton County moving forward in a progressive and positive position, and let's keep Mike Register in the position of chief, and let's go forward with the process of making that permanent and not interim. Thank you very much for your time tonight.
Thank you. Lloyd Hamilton.
Chairman Turner and Board of Commissioners, thank you for allowing me to address the body. My name is Lloyd Hamilton. I'm the spokesperson for the 100 homes or so of the Foxfield subdivision in Rex. We have a very active neighborhood watch. In fact, we're entering our seventh year. And most of the watch members that were at the that are active were at the first meeting as well, so we got a long history of our neighborhood watch, and it's doing very well. We have new members occasionally. We have, one of the things we have is different hours of that people are awake. Sometimes in the middle of the night, sometimes some people will get up before the sun's up. So we got quite a variety of people who are active in the watch and who've got eyes and ears and watch our neighborhood. We watch everybody's, we're there for everybody's benefit, even those who are not part of the watch itself. We watch out for each other. We have a good rapport with the county, with all departments. Our quarterly meetings, we send in a minutes to the county along with a copy of the sign-in sheet. We're able to spot problems very early. Our experience is we can see it coming and we do whatever is necessary to get the problem solved. On the other hand, we're quite willing to offer some praise whenever it's available. And I'm referring, of course, to Chief Register. We've noticed here over the last few months things that our neighbors have watched and spotted more patrols. The patrols in our neighborhood much more often now. We get a quicker response now than we used to. Our neighbors have a safer feeling with Chief Register at the helm. And we don't talk to the patrol a lot, but some every once in a while we will. And the morale just seems to be so good among the patrolmen that we do speak to. So I would recommend the taxpayers of Foxfield recommend to this board that Chief Registers be made permanent. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Jerry Bedingfield.
Mr. Turner, commissioners, I wanted to speak tonight. I'm going to get right out of the way. Everything Gail said,
Could you please state your county of residency?
My name is Jerry Cordell Bedingfield. I live in Rex, Georgia. I moved here in 1962. Worked at the first donut shop we ever had, Mr. Donut, in Forest Park, and it shows. But what I want to say tonight is basically that we appreciate y'all's help. We like change. We like to see things moving forward. And I see some great men, even under Mr. Register, that we don't have a problem if we can keep them here. We need to figure out somehow or another, and I'm not fussing, to cut the budget, not buy extra land, waste a lot of money. We need another 100 to 200 policemen in this county to where we can say that we're the safest, the quickest call, and have enough detectives that can work anything to where we can keep this thing in a county moving forward to where instead of staying where we're at or moving backwards. I see this new change. I have seen it in the past. I'm not looking down at anyone in the past. I'm looking forward for the future. And I really expect all of y'all, when I come in, if you would, please, if we have something positive to help our communities, think about it, pray about it, and see what we can do as a joint team with the public. Now, Gail's got a lot of friends, but I've got about 3,000 or 4,000 Facebook friends, and I've got about 200 to 300 people down there because I talk more than she does. And when I talk to them, they don't want us fussing and arguing and fighting. We just have to work through our problems and just keep going ahead. I didn't want the new bridge, but we got it. And I see the values now, because now we've got the old bridge that takes all the traffic off. We've had a couple of films down there and the television commercials. So change is tough, especially when the lights are coming in your window and, you know, and the noise is a lot louder, you know. And that was a struggle. But it was a positive struggle that you take something bad and make something good out of it. So this county needs to really pull together and work in a good, positive direction and try to be that shining jewel that we keep talking about and just try to get a lot more business and the economic development and more movies in here. And I believe, I may be wrong, but the next 5 years, I think we're going to have something really good. And it's really good to see the county working with all the cities, listening, got the opening and the talking going on, to, because that way we know what to deal with, where the problems and the troubles are. Now, I'll be coming to y'all because we need handicapped parking in Rex. Now that we don't have all that traffic, we need the no parking signs move. And some of these older people that come to see our monument, the Melvina Shields monument and other things.
Excuse me, Mr. Benefield, your 3-minute time limit has
expired. Sorry, and I apologize, and I told you I talked more.
You did warn us. Yes, sir, you did warn us. Thank you. Nia Walker.
Good afternoon, board. My name is Nia Sade Walker, and I am a citizen, a resident of Clayton County District 3, and I'm also a member of the Clayton County NAACP branch. I wanted to share with you all an email that I wrote on Monday to the board in regards to reinstating Chief Greg Porter, former Chief Greg Porter. I'm writing this email in hopes of persuading you to reinstate Greg Porter as Chief of Police here in Clayton County. I have no ill feelings or disregard for our current interim chief register. However, I believe that Chief Porter is better fitting for the position as chief of police, considering the current state of Clayton County as well as America in regards to law enforcement. What I know about Greg Porter is that he was a chief of integrity and he held his police officers accountable. As one of the lead organizers for the Clayton County Coalition for Justice and Police Accountability, Chief Porter's position in firing former officer Ryan Hall led to an indictment on charges of battery against an elder in Clayton County community, Daruba Ben Wahad, and it was crucial to our coalition's position and demands. There is plenty of wrongdoings going on with the misconduct of police forces across the country. Chief Porter did what many chiefs across the country have failed to do when unnecessary and inexplicable harm is done to community members by the hands of police. Chief Porter has shown to hold his officers accountable, which reinforced feelings of safety and trust in the Clayton County Police Department by citizens. It is disturbing to know that the people's chief was removed from his position without reasonable cause or open record to justify what we, the community, perceive as wrongful demotion. It is my hope that at today's meeting, and when you all vote whether or not to reinstate Greg Porter, you will take into consideration the request of the community members and vote yes for reinstating Greg Porter. Thank you for my time. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Pastor Derek Rice.
My name is Derek Rice. I am a resident of Fulton County. I'm a pastor of Sankofa United Church of Christ. I'm a member of the Concerned Black Clergy of Atlanta, and the Samuel DeWitt Proctor National Pastors Conference. And I'm here to respectfully request that you all vote to reinstate Chief Greg Porter as Chief of Police here. I represent an extremely concerned group of individuals regarding this issue. We've met with and or communicated with each one of the members of this commission over the past 3 months or so. And the best reason that we've been given with regard to why Chief Porter was removed after 10 of 12 public speakers asked you not to the first time the vote was done, after for 2 years Chief Porter's official evaluation signed by Chairman Turner was 96 and 97% respectively, after Chief Porter's investigation led to both misdemeanor and felony indictments of rogue officers, people still have the audacity to suggest that morale is low in the department. Common sense says morale would be low when rogue officers' behavior that seems to be supported in other police departments across the country are punished to the full extent here in Clayton County. The best reason that we've been given for why Chief Porter was removed is he did something wrong. But nobody can tell us, or we believe no one can tell us, what that something is. And injustice has been done. This board can make a statement to the country that says we do care about the lives of individuals who've been terrorized by out-of-control officers. Your ancestors, four of you, dreamed that you would have a day that you could sit in these seats because of an injustice that they experienced. They dreamed that you would do justice when you got here. They dreamed that you would move humbly when you got here. They dreamed that you would fight for righteousness. They did not dream that you would allow for political and personal issues to color your decisions. They dreamed that you would do what was right. So we're pleading with you. Please vote for justice. The reality is the man has a year left. He wants to retire in dignity. He would spend physically maybe 6 months in this seat. If we're really talking about doing what's right, vote him back in, and if it's about Register's ability to do right by animals, let him run animal control. Thank you so much for my time.
Andrea Barrett.
Thank you. My name is Andrina Merritt. I'm a resident of DeKalb County. My son, Officer Darrell Wallace.
Ma'am, please speak more into the mic, please.
I'm sorry. My son is Officer Darrell Wallace, who lost his life in the line of duty on March 15th. I'm here on his behalf. I'm here on behalf of his fellow officers, who I have spoken to at length since his death. I'm here to beg you and urge you not to reinstate Gregory Porter as Chief of Police. I can only speak to my experience. I don't have the luxury of being a resident of this county or knowing of his record. I can only speak to my experience during one of the worst times of my life. Chief Porter, to me, displayed a lack of integrity, a lack of transparency, the very thing the mission statement of his office said it would uphold. We had some questions about the integrity of the vehicle Darrell was driving, and we openly expressed them to him in a closed door meeting, and that was probably about 4 months ago after such meeting. We were told before then that I would receive his badge. I would receive a corrected death certificate that said he wasn't on a job when he was killed. And I would receive a copy of the skirt report from the Georgia State Patrol, none of which I received from Mr. Porter after that meeting. It has been just recently that we've been presented with the badge. I was just given a call a week ago and said that we are working on the death certificate to have it corrected. I have subsequently received a copy of that skirt report from the Georgia State Patrol. it hurts me, you know, that the silence was deafening after that meeting. And I urge you, after speaking to many of the officers and being able to reconnect with them, there was a connection, and I once believed that he was a man of integrity when I first encountered him. But he's proven to me not to be that. He has not spoken to us since that meeting. And so I urge you today, please, vote that he not be reinstated. We have a little more ways to go. Daryl was given a day of recognition in Clayton County. I would be hard-pressed to have to work with this individual because of the lack of integrity I think he has shown to my family and to the rest of the department. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Merritt, and we do honor you and your son for the time he spent with us. Yes. Ms. Connie Rice. Ms. Connie Rice. Jim Carter.
Jim Carter, I've lived in Clayton County for 46 years, and I reside in Jonesboro. I'm back. I was here last time, and I started out by mentioning to you that quite by accident, I learned that we have had a morale problem on the Clayton County Police Force. I called 911 early in the morning. An officer came to my house and took care of the situation. And after taking care of that situation, I asked him how things were going on the police force since there had been a change. I've met Chief Register and I had met Chief Porter. Know really nothing about either one. Can't say that I know either one of them personally, but this officer told me that morale had improved 90% on the police force since Chief Register had taken over. And that kind of got my attention. So I started making some phone calls, and I have made many phone calls since the last meeting, and I continue to hear from many officers, law enforcement people in this county, how much morale has improved since the change in leadership. We should all be concerned about that we have high morale, not only in the police department, but other departments in the county. We all benefit from that. I talked to one officer on the phone who told me that he had been planning to move to Cobb County and leave Clayton County. But after the change was made, he decided to stay here. And as far as I know, he is still here. We need to look into that situation. And if morale has improved, I don't think you're voting in the best interest of Clayton County if you're not behind the police department and anything and everything you can do to improve morale among the police department, because all of us benefit from that. I've heard people talk about accountability. I think we should hold the police chief accountable for the morale in the police department. I don't care who the police chief is. We should hold the police chief accountable for the morale in that department. There is so much that I could say. I love Clayton County. I have not ran from Clayton County like I've seen many people do over the years. I've been here since 1969, and I've seen a lot of problems. I still think Clayton County is the best place to be. With the right leadership, we can improve the school system. We saw a board tear this school system apart. With the right leadership, we can improve property values. We can attract businesses back to this county. Right now, people are going out of Clayton County to buy cars, to shop for groceries, to buy clothes, because so many businesses have abandoned Clayton County.
Excuse me, Mr. Carter, your 3-minute time limit has expired.
Thank you, sir. How are we on time, Madam Clerk?
We still have about 5 more minutes, Mr. Chairman.
Say again, please.
We still have about 5 more minutes.
Okay, good. Dr. Lakeisha Porter.
Good Greetings, Commissioners. Thank you for this opportunity to speak to you today and express my concerns. My name is Dr. Lakeisha Porter, and my father is Chief Gregory Porter. I currently reside in Fulton County, but as a child, I was a resident of Clayton County, and I witnessed my father's tireless efforts and dedication to serving the citizens of Clayton County. For the past 29 years, he's continued his faithful dedication and service to the citizens of Clayton County with not less than a 95% evaluation rating. Just to name a few of his many accomplishments, under Chief Porter's leadership, the crime rate was significantly reduced, a new community and problem-oriented policing program was implemented, there was promotional diversity, additional police precincts, and departmental efficiency. Given Chief Porter's overall accomplishments for the betterment of Clayton County, it behooves the commissioners to officially reinstate him as Chief of Police. It is my hope that you refocus your attention to the citizens of Clayton County and the betterment of this county and make data-driven decisions to include officially reinstating Chief Gregory Porter as the Chief of Police of Clayton County. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Reverend Joseph Willer.
I was about to run out of time. Good evening, distinguished members of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, Honorable Chairman, fellow citizens of Clayton County. I'm Reverend Joseph Wheeler, resident of Riverdale for 29 years, community activist for 29 years. I've worked with both Chief Porter and Chief Turner and Chief Clackham and several others. I've been here a long time. I've seen the police department change over the years. I've watched the character go up and down. I was there when a young man was killed on the side of I-75 with a bullet wound to his head. Couldn't find the weapon. We had to have a coroner's inquest. Still couldn't find the weapon. Officers got off. I was there over in Camp Street when the young man was shot and the police said it was a home invasion without doing the investigation. I was there. The people called me, asked me what's going on with the police department. This police department has come a long way. I was there when they wrote N-words on your locker, on your paper. I watched this county. I've been here. I know what goes on here. And I know that Clayton County has a hemorrhaging of businesses leaving the county, but we see no plan or no remedy. There's no concerted effort by Clayton County leaders. Foreclosure's still high, property taxes high, and that's what we should be focusing on instead of being bogged down over some petty, sleazy politics. This is retaliation against Greg Porter. It's retaliation. And unfortunately, people inside the department and outside are involved. And that's what makes it very odorous. So what we're simply saying, we're going to be protesting in Clayton County until we all can sing from the same hymn book, because the people need to know the true narrative. The narrative that was given early on was not the correct narrative. We've been lied to. We've been told that he had something in his records that would warrant firing. We couldn't find it. We asked for it under the Open Records Act. We couldn't find it. No one knows. We were lied to. One commissioner even told us she hadn't heard from a constituent. That was false. That was false. The ministers were lied to, the civil rights leaders were lied to, the voters are being lied to. We're calling on the Clayton County Board of Commissioners to do the right thing. We'll be protesting until we do.
Mr. Chairman, we have time for one more speaker.
Say again.
Mr. Chairman, we have time for one more speaker.
Mr. Timothy Merritt.
Thank you all, Board of Commissioners, Chairman Turner, and everyone that has spoken thus far. I am the father of Officer Darrell Wallace that was slaughtered and killed in a car. I hear statements, and I saw with my own eyes my white brothers and sisters treated as if they were dogs out here and if they didn't have integrity because they may have a different point of view. But righteousness means that an individual will diligently inquire and seek to find the truth. We were told by former chief, now removed, Greg Turner, that he would check into information for us. He did not. We were told certain things that he would do. We saw paperwork that was actually done incorrectly on purpose, and nothing was done about it. We were told that we were going to get a skirt report, we were going to get the vehicle maintenance of the vehicle, and we didn't get it until Chief Register came. We were told to throw you all up under the bus. We were told that you all, there were supposed to be cars that were given, and the cars were not given. And so we were supposed to come here and throw you all under the bus that you all didn't do what was supposed to be done. But my wife said, the Bible says if you got an ought, go to that person. And you go to that person and you diligently inquire. I went to the person and I saw the T-splots. I saw different things that were there. And now we have another chief register that made the ball start moving. Do you think it's easy to go look at the grave and you see your son covered under the dirt? Because I don't see him, I know his body is not there. I know what the Bible says, but to know that his corpse is there, and the only thing he ever said he was afraid of is my car. The steering on my car is a problem. I've seen the car, and the only thing that is missing is the steering column. And yet people would get upset and say that there was integrity. I was told things and it didn't happen. I was lied to that this will be taken. This is like my son. Well, if it was my son, rest fully assured, I would diligently inquire like the Bible says, and I would see about it being done. Let me change my voice.
Yes, please.
The Bible says when something happens, if a person has been told that there's a problem, this is Exodus chapter 21, for the people that are in the clergy should do what the Bible says, diligently inquire. Nobody asks us a doggone thing. Diligently inquire, and if an ox kills a person, if the ox had killed a person and been told about it, see about it. Exodus 21, 28 through 31. I won't read it all. Exodus 21, 28 through 31. I thank you for letting me come. And I thank God for Clayton County putting a chief of police there that would care about my wife, who has suffered grievously since my son died because of the stress. That time she can't breathe. She almost died one night because of the stress level. And you think I don't care? I do. Chief Porter promised me things. He's told me things that I haven't told you all, some things that I know that are not legal, and if it was shown on the video, you wouldn't believe it. But you want to inquire? Polygraph me. When I pass it, you pay for it. If I don't, I pay for it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That concludes public comment. If your name was not called, then you'll be the first up at the next public meeting in 2 weeks. I believe it's 2 weeks. Madam Clerk.
We will now have presentations. The first presentation is a MARTA update. Mr. Jerry Griffin.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, let me thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight and talk a little bit about MARTA and Clayton County. But let me begin by thanking you for giving me the opportunity to represent Clayton County on the MARTA board along with Ms. Abdul Salam.
Hold on, Jerry.
All right.
Pardon me for that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I think this is a good time. It came to my attention that there was a question about the upcoming bond issue that MARTA is about to have, in particular the flow of funds that involves Clayton County. So we decided that this would be an excellent opportunity. But before I get into that, let me just again thank you for making the decision to join with MARTA to provide transit for the citizens of this county. In doing so, you joined a system that's been in operation in two counties for over 40 years. You levied the 1% sales tax that allows MARTA to utilize those funds, and it benefits the entire system. A very unique feature, of course, of the Clayton County contract was that you required that one half of those funds be held for future commuter rail future rail service in Clayton County, and I can assure you, your board members are watching what goes on with that, and the finance people at MARTA are doing a diligent job in doing that. As you know, I think preliminary planning is underway on rail now. The survey of the available right-of-way from Norfolk Southern, we have done a contract, and that study is underway now. Right now, we have 7 bus routes in the county, and last month it hauled nearly 6,000 people on daily, and then on Saturdays we had about 4,400 people in August. If we were not part of MARTA, a couple of these bus routes could not operate. They're just not feasible. But because you are part of a much larger system, and some of the routes run through DeKalb or Fulton County and pick up additional riders, these routes are feasible, and ridership continues to increase. And I think as we move forward, things will increase much more. As Roberta and I have discovered, though, there are many, many moving parts in this system. The buses we see going down our streets are just the final output. Our operating budget for 2016 is $512 million, and then we have a capital budget of about $432 million. And, of course, part of that is the financing of that system is the utilization of debt. I received a question just about the role of Clayton County and the Clayton County funds and the flow of things, flow of those funds through the MARTA financing system and the capital financing system. Mr. Chairman, I have asked Mr. Kevin Hurley, who is the Director of Treasury, to be here tonight, and if he could, I would like for him to make a brief presentation with some slides to kind of, I think, draws a beautiful picture of where those funds. We also have Mr. Woody Vaughn from Holland and Knight, who is a bond counsel, and Tom Louth from Deaton, who is the disclosure counsel, to share the strategy for the upcoming issue. And if I could, I'd like to ask Mr. Hurley to come up and,
yes,
and,
sir,
and
on the floor.
Give you that information.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin, for the introduction. Chairman Turner, distinguished members of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, I appreciate the opportunity to come down and give a presentation tonight. Mr. Griffin was painting the picture that MARTA's going out to issue bonds. And as a part of doing that, it was a good time to come down and actually walk the commission through the flow of funds related to those bonds. So without further ado, we're gonna talk a little bit about the sales tax collections for MARTA overall, as well as the sales tax collections that are coming from Clayton County. Then I'll show you the flow of funds of those tax receipts. And then we'll talk a little bit about the validation and the significance of the bond validation. Give a conclusion, and then answer any questions that you all would like to ask. The sales tax collections. And I'm going to paint this from a picture of selling bonds. That's the context that we're having the discussion in. So as the sales tax proceeds increase, the bondholders benefit from an increasing sales tax receipt. The red line noted on this chart is actually the sales tax collection forecast that MARTA had prior to the addition of Clayton County. The blue line on that chart shows the MARTA forecast sales tax with the addition of Clayton County starting in FY15 and 16. This is our forecast for Clayton County receipts for FY16. As you'll note, the blue line is the budgeted amount. It's about $12 million for the first 3 months, and we've actually received about $13 million, couple hundred thousand dollars. So we're ahead of budget from a tax collection perspective. the flow of those funds when they come to MARTA and how they are utilized when we have to pay our debt service on the bonds. The pledge of the validation pledges to the bondholders the sales tax proceeds. And you'll note in the first box there, the Georgia Department of Revenue collects the sales tax receipts from the individual businesses. Once it comes into the Georgia Department of Revenue, those funds will flow from the Department of Revenue over to MARTA's bond trustee. MARTA doesn't touch the funds, they go directly to the bond trustee, and they'll flow through a debt service waterfall of all the debt that MARTA has issued. And so it'll come into the trustee, flows through, we pay all the individual debt issues that we owe money for, and then it comes out of the bottom end of that waterfall, and those proceeds wind up making their way to MARTA for use in the operating and capital budgets. I wanted to show prior to Clayton that Fulton and DeKalb proceeds actually accommodate all the existing debt, since those are the debt has been issued for the services provided in those counties. So this is the March 2015 summary of our debt, I guess you would call it our debt reconciliation that we have with the bond trustee before the proceeds are sent to MARTA. You'll note that the first line, that's the proceeds coming in from Fulton and DeKalb to the trustee. The total amount of debt service to set aside for that month is $12 million. The net sales tax coming to MARTA to be used in the general fund flows out of the bottom here. And that's how we conduct the operations and capital investment using those funds there. With the addition of Clayton County, what I've done is I've showed the flow of funds and I've broken it out to where we have the Fulton and DeKalb proceeds as well as the Clayton County proceeds. And this is the debt service reconciliation for the prior month of in September. If you'll note, the proceeds coming from Clayton County is about $4.4 million as it flows into the waterfall. And as we go through the waterfall and come out the other end, the sales tax receipts for Clayton County to be spent on the service in Clayton County is $4.4 million. So when this all flows through MARTA, the amount coming in is the amount coming out. Just so you guys know that we're not, those funds are still being set aside specifically for Clayton service. Now, once it comes to MARTA, in our intergovernmental agreement, and Mr. Griffin noted that MARTA is setting aside half a penny of the proceeds to support the commuter rail development process in Clayton County. This transfer is 50% of what we collect that month is being set aside in a reserve strictly for that activity. The remaining $2.2 million then flows into the MARTA General Fund with the remainder of Fulton and DeKalb, and it allows us to pay the operators and things like that that directly support the service. The significance of the validation and the flow of the funds through that waterfall is pretty big. While we're safeguarding the Clayton proceeds to be utilized for Clayton, what happens is we are allowed to use the higher tax collection as the basis to sell the bonds. So the significance of having the higher sales tax collections results in a higher debt coverage ratio. And simply the debt coverage ratio is how much the sales tax is compared to how much the debt service payments are. And we want to target greater than the sales tax being two times higher than the amount of the debt service that we're paying. That's kind of an industry standard. When we combine This debt coverage ratio, as it increases, it's viewed as a significant positive by the rating agencies. That's Moody's, Standard & Poor's, Fitch, and they're the ones that provide the ratings on the bonds that we sell. When we combine, MARTA has gone through a significant turnaround in its finance, world, and so combined with these successes, the additional Clayton sales tax could also lead to higher bond ratings. And we actually went up to New York last week and pitched to the rating agencies this new bond issue, and they were very well received. So we'll know on October 28th if we're going to receive any bond upgrades from the rating agencies. What these higher ratings result in is lower interest rates. So overall, the higher the rating, the lower we have to pay on our debt service. Lower interest rates result in the lower cost of borrowing. That's good for MARTA. That's good for Clayton County. The validation that we're going through is necessary to pledge those bonds to be able to issue debt. If MARTA is to move forward and build the Clayton commuter rail option in a timely fashion, there will be some need to issue debt to support the construction of that project. Without the validation of the Clayton sales tax, we would have lower ratings. We would not be able to pledge Clayton bonds to support the debt. Therefore, that might extend the execution of the project. Allowing the validation would allow us to issue the debt and handle that project in a more timely and efficient fashion on a shorter time frame. The pay-go scenario I discussed here would be we would have to save up the proceeds in order to put the system in place. The last bullet here is that the bonding that we're talking about is it's already in place in the agreement that we have with Clayton County. It's something that we've planned on. The forecast on when the commuter rail option will start moving is already in our budget forecasts. And so those bonds that we would issue to construct that are something that we would forecast to use. It's in there right now. The result of adding the Clayton County tax to the MARTA sales tax as far as the coverage ratio that I was discussing. Prior to the addition of Clayton County, you can note we have our sales tax is 2.3 times higher than our debt service. And it's forecast to grow to 3.15 times our debt service over the next 5 years. With the addition of Clayton County, we sit right now at 2.79 times our debt service with a growth to 3.8. That's a significant growth factor that helped us make the case to the rating agencies this last week. In conclusion, validating the Clayton sales tax and applying it to the bond coverage, it allows us a more expeditious manner to execute the projects. It also gives us higher coverage ratios, and it will result in a probable lower cost of borrowing. And with that, I'd entertain any questions you all might have.
All right, thank you, sir. Commissioner Adamson.
Thank you for the presentation. In the beginning of the presentation, you talked about how this benefits bondholders. Bondholders specifically benefit because you're pledging Clayton County money for these bonds. I understand with the rapid transit agreement and under recent advice of legal counsel that we don't have any grounds to object to this. We gave that away when we negotiated or voted on this contract with MARTA. So my comments are really just voicing concerns. I can't do anything about it. But when MARTA pledges our money for your debt, you're putting our money at risk for your obligations. And it makes me think about that parent that in all best interest and in good faith lends money on a car loan to their child and then ends up having to eat the car loan because the child didn't make the payments. And I want you to explain how putting our money and pledging our money that's supposed to be used for rapid transit in Clayton County, it's supposed to be in this lockbox, but pledging it towards your debt to benefit your bondholders. Now, Clayton County is not a bondholder, right?
No, sir, they're not a bondholder.
Okay, so by benefiting the bondholders, this is not benefiting Clayton County. And by pledging it against your debt, I realize it can help your credit rating, but you said that this could also help with projects such as commuter rail in Clayton County. So can you tell me within that bond agreement that you're currently negotiating, what projects specifically will be funded by these bonds in Clayton County, the dollar amount of those projects, and the timeline at which they will be implemented with the proceeds of these bonds?
That was a lot of questions, sir. I'd like to go back to the beginning, and then we'll come back to the project questions. Could you repeat your first question on the
bondholders benefit?
Yes, bondholders
by benefit. Pledging Clayton County money.
Yes,
that you're taking from us through the Department of Revenue and giving it to the trustees of your debt.
It's
which means that we are taking on risk of your debt, right?
No, sir.
What happens if you defaulted on that debt?
Clayton County taxpayers will not be taking on the burden of the Fulton IndyCab debt. The MARTA Board of Directors has approved and been in place for many years a policy that only allows 45% of the MARTA sales tax collections to be used for debt. That in itself provides a 2x debt coverage ratio with or without Clayton County.
So then why is our money going to the trustee?
Because what that does is it makes our debt coverage ratio from a 2 to a 2.35.
Because it's inside of the debt validation.
Because it's part of the debt validation.
Which means it is at risk.
It's only at risk if MARTA were to go well above 45% of our sales tax to support debt.
Sure, I understand that. And it may or may not be unlikely to cite that parent that co-signs the kid's car, but in fact, it is putting our funds at risk.
It's not putting them at risk from my perspective. The Board of Directors has built in a security blanket that does not allow that to happen.
Even though it's in the bond validation?
Even though it's in the bond validation. Okay. The only thing that bond validation provides is the increase in the coverage ratios.
So tell me about these Clayton County commuter rail projects that you identified that are going to be funded by this bond issuance.
Right now, as you saw on the flow of funds, on this particular page, there are no bonds that are going to be issued utilizing Clayton County sales tax to support them. The Clayton County commuter rail will not start for 5 or 6 years into the future, the actual construction thereof. We will be using PAYGO funds collected through this $2 million a month to support the planning efforts to construct that project.
So go back to the waterfall, please. So after... Yes.
Which what this is
the waterfall, the arrows that you had that you referred to as a waterfall, that one. So our money goes to the trustees of a bond per a bond validation agreement.
And it does that right now.
So you're using our money for debt that's not being used for projects in Clayton County at this time.
The payments for that debt are coming from this bucket of money right here.
Right, which is graphically was in the same thing on the top left, right?
Yes.
Sales tax from DeKalb, Clayton, and Fulton County. So you're taking our money and using it to service debt that's not, what does that say right there? All
that's
debt service.
That's the flow of the funds.
Right.
Bonds, every cent we get from the Department of Revenue comes in one chunk of money. And it goes right to the Department of Revenue, who sends it to the trustee.
Which is
that is not paid yet.
That's right. And the trustee is the entity that collects and disperses the money for a bond, for debt. And if there was no debt, it would go
inside the proceeds, and then twice a year they disperse that to the bondholders. Yes, sir.
Fair enough. If there was no debt, it would go from the Department of Revenue directly to MARTA. There wouldn't be a trustee. Is that right?
Yes, sir. I would imagine.
So because there is debt, our money is going to the trustee of that debt rather than to MARTA to be used to, as that says, service all debt service requirements before whatever portions come back to MARTA to be used for something as yet to be determined. So how I don't understand why, in your opinion, our money is not being at risk for those obligations of MARTA outside of Clayton County.
Because the MARTA board has set a policy where only 45% of it can be used for debt service. And if you actually apply that to the amount of debt that's outstanding and any future projections, we are not allowed to build a budget that violates that policy. The addition of Clayton County, we are setting those funds aside specifically for the Clayton component. When we go to issue bonds to directly support Clayton County, those proceeds will be used to pay for the debt associated with the heist.
But these bonds that you're talking about issuing right now are not for the benefit of any projects in Clayton County.
No, sir. They are.
I don't have any more questions.
And they are being funded out of the other county.
Thank you.
Come on up, Ms.
Issue is the revenue department issues one check for the MARTA tax, and the MARTA tax is collected in Fulton, DeKalb, and Clayton County. So one check goes into MARTA. It's not three checks. It's not separating out a portion of the MARTA tax. So it's done internally, and that's what we get the reports on, and you get the reports on every month is what's happening within MARTA. But the revenue department only issues one check for one tax, and that's MARTA. It's not a Clayton County issue.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin.
I have a question.
Commissioner
so
Rooks.
Conversely, let's use it this way. The 55%, since we're talking about the 45% that's used for debt, what's the 55%? What's the number that you let's use the number that you had on your board.
Okay, so you're
from there.
So on this one, it's not really 55% because we're only using about 40% right now.
Okay, so 60%.
This is 60% of the available sales tax to pay for bond issue, for debt service. And what that does is that flows down here into our general fund, and we use that to buy assets. We use that to pay our operators.
Right.
To pay all of our contracts.
So 60% would include the $2,214,000. I can't see the rest of that.
Yes, ma'am.
It
would include that.
That 60% is not used for the debt.
That's correct.
Okay. And that includes the $2 million that we've set aside for the rail.
No, the rail's coming out right here and being put in a
right.
Where it says after debt service.
Well, what they're due for, we recognize that half of that is set aside for.
But the other half does go into the general fund, and that's to pay the operators running Clayton.
Right. We understand. Yeah. So there is half a penny to run the buses that we're getting,
yes,
and the operators and the operation of that.
Yes, ma'am.
What is, I want to be clear, is the other half that is not being used that we believe is being set aside in an account,
yes.
You're not utilizing that in that 40% number that you mentioned earlier.
That is correct.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. My statement is simply, Mr. Griffin and Representative Abdul Salon, if y'all could just talk to Mr. Parker about using some of that money you're setting aside to get some shelters for the people standing on the side of the road.
Pick up the garbage.
Trash cans.
Since it's our money sitting in reserve, while we're waiting on rail, we can get the people out of these elements.
We can't legally do that.
I don't think so.
I know legally,
I know.
But we just
we
put
can't.
It out. Won't hurt.
I have
a
question.
I have
yeah,
a question
Commissioner
for Mr.
Hamburg.
Griffin. Mr. Griffin.
Mr. Griffin, please come to the podium.
You mentioned there is a study being done, including rail. Now, I've heard of the studies being done, including rail in Alpharetta. I think the northern part of DeKalb County, but I have not heard of any rail being talked about for Clayton County. Last time I heard that Norfolk was not familiar with any rails being used here in Clayton County.
Well, they're part of the study that's going on right now. In fact, we're paying them to conduct the study of their available right-of-way through Clayton County. Right now, from East Point down through Lovejoy. That study is currently underway.
Is that for the state of Georgia? Is that for Clayton County and MARTA?
That's for MARTA.
Yeah.
To use the right-of-way that exists there to expand commuter rail, you know, to bring commuter rail into being through Clayton County.
What's that timetable?
There, right now, the study is underway.
No, timetable for rail for Clayton County.
I don't know that there is one until we do the study.
The study is ongoing, and that was discussed with Ms. Roberta Abdul-Salam last time she came out. So that's an ongoing initiative.
It's ongoing, and, you know, and it's something that we want very much. But right now, the focus has been on getting the bus lines up and running, to getting the bus right, to get the trash cans and the shelters and those things done. Hey, I
didn't see. Ms. Long, you have something to add.
So anyway, that's underway, that part, the rail. And, of course, now I also point out, you're talking about the operating costs. You know, MARTA began service out here 2 months before they got a cent. So we started off because they were anxious, just as you were. Ms. Alam, I assure you, was pushing to get the bus lines up and running, and we did before the sales tax even began. And they're continuing to grow, I mean, the lines, and we've got, three more opening in
December.
Four in December that are coming online. So, you know, we're going to try to get that in place right now while the study is going on the rail corridor, to see what is available. And once we find that out, that's the time then we have to make some decisions about acquiring right-of-way or some alternative routing. And land and right-of-way is extremely
expensive.
Okay, but for now,
what the study is looking
for now, can our representatives push to have the trash cans and the shelters?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Excuse me, may I?
Yes.
I know you asked me to be here, but you didn't ask me to come up, so I just said it.
Ms. Long.
I never tell you.
Thank you. Ms. Hamrick and Ms. Gregory was at a meeting recently for the ministers, and I did make a report that the MARTA officials had discussed a proposal that some of us in the community had been talking about. And MARTA had actually agreed the actual time frame that they had the exercise, MAX, I think it was, the exercise at the airport. We had proposed probably about 3 months ago that if MARTA would provide the garbage cans, that there were community organizations in the community that were willing to help, you know, police the areas. And when I made the information available at the Association of Christian Ministers, every last one of them said, we'll do that. What we proposed was something called Adopt a Stop. It works in other cities, and other communities, and everybody agreed to do that. MARTA has found and agreed to provide, if you've seen some of the areas, the very nice black wrought iron, heavy duty, upper class, first rate equipment, trash cans and benches that match. And they are installing them. What the gentleman has been helping me do with your system here is to pull up the information that they had emailed that actually has some of the time frames and locations where they're trying to do that. They have a phase one where they've done shelters and still can't see it. Church Street and Town Center is where they propose, in front of City Hall. Lamar Hutchison Parkway and Valley Hill Road, State Route 85 and Bethsaida Road, State Route 85 and Allen Drive, Mount Zion Road and King William Drive, and the woods at South Lake Apartments, Upper Riverdale Road at Leeds Mill Road near the existing car wash, Garden Walk Boulevard at Garden Ridge Drive, and I can tell you that one's already been installed. I actually passed by the morning they were digging, and I've gone by several times. The shelter is installed, Clayton State University. Those were the first eight. They also have a proposed phase two. Phase two includes an additional four shelters. Phase three includes another four shelters. We still didn't get all of this working.
I agree with what you're saying. It's a great idea, but I just think, you know, as a commissioner, we are already asking our citizens to do a lot and trying to help us keep the rest of the county, and I feel like MARTA's just adding that on. No, and I know your presentation was supposed to be mostly finance, but I had to throw my little thing in. I just really feel like we asking too much.
But this is what we, being new to a MARTA system, which is the ninth largest transportation system in the country, what we have to learn and understand all over the country, these are partnerships everywhere. MARTA provides the transportation. They don't do the garbage pickup.
But we're paying for it.
They don't do that.
No
transit system does that. That's what I'm trying to get you to understand. And I really do wish that you all would go to some of these national conferences, go to some of these trainings, because there really isn't that. You're paying, and you're not paying MARTA. We are MARTA. You've got to start thinking about, we are MARTA. You're not paying somebody to do us a service. We are the service. I mean, this is something new, and we're all learning it. We just came back from San Francisco, where I'm proud to say that Keith Parker was named Transportation Manager of the Year.
Let me just say that part of the whole issue here, the contract that you signed with MARTA actually says you'll pay up to $1 million a year for garbage. Mm. You know, we don't want to do that if we don't have to. And also, you talk about shelters and benches. Part of that is right away. Some of those do not have a place for a shelter or a bench.
But Jerry. Mm-hmm.
But we're working on that. The issue is real. We know that. I ride the bus just to see where the things are, and there is some need there.
But the other issue is that MARTA does not provide the shelters. The advertising agency does that. And the advertising agency has not signed the contract that includes Clayton County. I mean, you know, we're talking about real contractual things. And one of the questions that Jerry Griffin and I asked about 3 months ago, right here in this building, of MARTA's legal officials, can the county enter into a contract with our own advertising agency that would do that for us? We have not received an answer yet. But we're looking out for Clayton County. We're looking out for the best of Clayton County because we want the best for Clayton County. The advertising agencies across the country provide those amenities. So in the interim, we were trying to figure out a way not only not have to pay, but generate some income. So we were trying to figure out a way in the interim, and MARTA agreed to provide the garbage cans and the benches in the interim. So, I mean, please understand, nobody's taking advantage because we're not going to allow it. And anybody in this room that knows me, anybody know me?
All right. Well, we appreciate the presentation and the information. Did any of the board members have any other questions?
If you have any questions about this, you know, just don't hesitate to call us.
No. I want to know a little bit more about the bond and the bond deal and all. Then? And what is that going to cost the Clayton residents?
It will cost the Clayton
nothing.
Residents.
Nothing.
Okay. When does that come up? When does it come up?
We actually will press the bond deal on November the 5th, and we close it on December the 10th. And what you saw in the flow through, the Clayton County sales tax collections will continue to flow all the way through that waterfall and come out the other end. The intent is to get a better rating. It's not to use Clayton funds to support a debt issue at this point.
Our money's going to go for transit.
For what it's supposed to go to.
For what it's supposed to.
Thank you. I appreciate y'all time. Madam Clerk, next presentation.
Next presentation is the Economic Development Update presented by Courtney Pope, the Director of Economic Development.
Good evening, Chairman and Commissioners. My name is Courtney Pope from the Office of Economic Development. I'm here to give you a brief update of some of the items being here for 3 months on the job here in Clayton County. Clayton County, as I describe, is the heart of Atlanta's Southern Crescent.
We're seeing a brand that's being created throughout the region, and so we consider ourselves the heart. You look at the seal behind you, it definitely shows that Clayton is definitely the heart of Atlanta's Southern Crescent. Basically, what is economic development? In my job, or the job that you hired me to do, is to promote and goal to create and retain jobs in Clayton County, but also to stabilize and maintain the tax base in Clayton County. That is the simplest term or definition of economic development. So, an overview of economic development, the world is watching Clayton County. As far as the location of Clayton County, with the world's busiest airport being located 90% in Clayton County, with the number of companies locating to Clayton County being the Kroger, with a $175 million project, with Castellini, which opened up last week, with a $60 million project, and with Falker Technologies with a $3 million investment. Several major companies have invested more than $300 million in Clayton County over the past 2 years, therefore creating over 1,000 jobs. That's something we should be proud of. The story we need to tell people about what we're doing in Clayton County. As I stated before, Clayton is the heart of Atlanta's Southern Crescent. A county snapshot. By doing some research, our population is roughly about 270,000 people. Our median household income is about $40,000. It's actually the lowest in the Southern Crescent, but actually rising in comparison with the state household income of $49,000. The unemployment rate is declining. It's currently 7.5%, down from a high of 13.1% in January 2010. Something to applaud ourselves for, but also we have more work to do. The homeownership rate is 55.3%. It's at your lowest in the Southern Crescent. Some things we need to work on as far as increasing home ownership in the county. The number of black-owned businesses is actually the highest in the state, 51.5%. Something most people don't know about, something we need to tell people that we are very business-friendly in Clayton County. Retail demand in Clayton County, almost $2.9 billion. That's the largest in Atlanta's Southern Crescent. Higher than Fayette, higher than Henry, higher than Coweta. Tell the story. People shop here, but we need to protect that $2.9 billion of investments or retail sales in Clayton County. We also had the highest number of retail businesses in Clayton County at roughly 1,980 businesses. What do I plan to do? Promote Clayton County. Of course, with your help, we all need to promote Clayton County. Tell the story, but focus on four main points. Emphasize our accessibility, our connections to the world, the airport, our highway system, our state highway system, and so on. We are connected to the world. Promote our expansion of existing industry clusters from retail to manufacturing to logistics to the film industry. Promote our successes. Let's talk about Kroger. Let's talk about Castellini. Let's talk about Falker Technologies. Let's talk about the programs we have in Clayton County and the jobs being created within the county. But also promote the county's investment in infrastructure. The Water Authority, the best in the world. Tell the story. The transportation, parks and recs, public safety. We need to tell the story of what the county is doing. Emphasize that and market it. Over the past few months, I reached out to the seven cities in Clayton County. I met with most of the mayors and most of the economic development professionals. Work with them. We want to work with them on a regular basis by having regular meetings with them. We've been doing that. I emphasize again, Clayton is the heart of Atlanta's Southern Crescent. One of the things we're doing, currently we're doing a business retention and expansion program. We have reached out to a number of businesses over the past few months. The program's been very successful. And what we're hearing is that they can't find people for jobs being created. But we're hearing on one side of the equation, but people can't find jobs. So somewhere there's a mismatch. We need to make sure both parties are coming together somehow, some way. We're gonna work on that. Most jobs are being created by existing businesses. Emphasize that. We're also bringing our Clayton County Public Schools, the CTA program. Clayton State, and Atlanta Tech as we do our site visits. Our plan for 2015 to 2016, fully implement the plan that was written in 2013. I believe it was sitting on some shelf somewhere, but we're gonna take it off the shelf and make sure it's fully implemented. Embrace and support the Atlanta Aerotropolis Alliance Initiative. The board and Chairman Turner have been attending all the meetings in regards to the Atlanta Aerotropolis. Maintain our business retention expansion program. Attract new companies to Clayton to expand our tax base and create new jobs. Enhance the economic development toolbox in Clayton County with new tools. Consider opportunity zones, enterprise zones, CIDs, community improvement districts. We need these tools to make sure that we protect the $2.9 billion being spent in this county, but also make sure we maintain our job and base here in the county. But overall, everyone must tell the Clayton story. Tell the Clayton story, the brand of Clayton County. It's the heart of Atlanta's Southern Crescent. The investments are made by the county, from parks and recs to the water authority. Talk about the improvement in the public school system. We have the highest graduation rate improvement last year at roughly 9%. People always ask about public safety in Clayton County. Well, we have the fifth largest police force in the state of Georgia. We also have one of the best trained fire departments in the state of Georgia. Tell the story. And over $300 million in private investment and 1,000 jobs being created over the past 2 years thanks to the vote role of this board. We all is together, shop local, support our businesses, support that $2.9 billion being spent in Clayton County, support the Atlanta Aerotropolis, and be a champion for Clayton County. Clayton County, the heart of Atlanta's Southern Crescent, but also emphasize that we're committed to Clayton, the business community is committed to Clayton, therefore we are all connected to the world. Commit to Clayton, connect to the world. That concludes my brief presentation, and any questions?
I have a brief one. You mentioned the brand. Would you be of the opinion that we need a brand consultant?
In some of the communities that I worked for previously, we did have a brand consultant, and economic development in Atlanta, in the Atlanta metro, is very competitive with most of my counterparts, DeKalb and Cobb and Coweta and Henry. They have hired brand consultants and outside parties to do their marketing for them. I talk to them on a regular basis, so the budgets they have for marketing alone range from $20,000 on a minimum to almost $200,000 just for a website. So in my honest opinion, it would be our best interest to have some type of brand consultant in that capacity.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Polk, for your presentation.
Thank you.
Madam Clerk.
The board will consider the request of Deborah Brewer, Director of Central Services.
Ms. Brewer, please take them all together unless a board member would like to take one separate. Hearing none, please proceed.
Central Services, good evening. Central Services has two items. The first is a recommendation for award for...
Speak more into the mic, please.
Recommendation for award for RFQ 2015-19, Influenza Vaccine Administration. The recommendation is to approve an award to the lowest responsive and responsible bidder, which is Rite Aid Headquarters, doing business as Rite Aid, located in Camp Hill, Pennsylvania. This service is to provide on-site flu shots at a cost of $20 per vaccine. The cost will be direct billed to the county's self-funded insurance for covered participants. The quote summary proposal and agreement are attached for your review and information. And there is a change to the contract. There's a change in the wording from county days to calendar days. And you have been provided with a copy of that. The second is a recommendation for award for RFQ 2015-21, Auditing Services for Clayton County Hospital Authority. The recommendation is to approve an award to the lowest responsive and responsible bidder, which is Draffin & Trucker LLP, located in Atlanta, Georgia, at a fee of $6,500. Funding is available through the auditing fees account. The quote summary and agreement are attached for your review and information. The request is for you to approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman or his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly.
All right, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Properly moved and seconded. Are there any questions on any of the items? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.
The board will now consider the request of Ramona Bivens, chief financial officer.
Please take them together.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I have six items for your consideration this evening. The first is Budget Amendment 2-68 for fiscal year 2015 professional services to amend an additional revenue in the amount of $1,366,335 for the payment of legal fees and litigation claims. Budget Amendment 2-69 is for FY15 other general government to amend an additional revenues in the amount of $1,857,197 for payment of utilities, claims, care and monitoring, sanitation expense, repair, maintenance, autos and trucks, and extraordinary items. Budget Amendment 2-70 is for FY15 Ellenwood Town Center redevelopment to amend the budget in the amount of $521,662 for the Ellenwood TAD to provide for agent fees and operating transfers out. Budget Amendment 2-71 is for FY15 debt service fund to transfer funds to cover the cost of debt service principal payment in the amount of $1,000. 2-13 is for FY16, 3% hotel motel discretionary fund to provide grant matching funds in the amount of $25,000 to Arts Clayton for roof repair. Budget Amendment 2-14 is for FY16 for senior services to amend in revenue in the amount of $13,789, which is the amount received from participants to cover the cost of an overnight trip. And that's all I have.
All right, is there a motion? I'll make the motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Probably moved and second. Are there any questions on any of the items?
I have just a question, Mr. Chairman. The last item, 2-14, just looking for some clarity. $13,789 to go for an overnight trip. Where is it at, or how many people are going?
Someone from Senior Services here, they collect the fees where the seniors, they pay, the participants pay to go on this trip.
Oh, these are for the participants.
This is for the participants.
Thank you for that clarification.
Okay.
Any other questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Thank you.
The board will now consider the request of Renee Bright, Human Resources Director.
Ms. Bright, please take all yours separately.
I'm sorry, separately.
Take them separately, okay. Yes.
The first item is a request to renew the vision coverage that's available to our employees and retirees through Davis Vision with an effective date of 6/1/2016. There are no recommended plan changes. However, the renewal does include 2.5% increase due to fees associated with the health care reform. The increase amounts to 17 cents per month for single coverage. There's no impact to the general fund as this is paid fully by the employees.
All right, is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Probably moved and second. Any questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Next item is a request from Juvenile Court Chief Judge Teske, who's requesting a reorganization of the court's administration as a result of additional state mandates. These mandates cannot be supported by the court's current structure, and therefore Judge Teske requests to delete the Chief of Staff position, which is a grade 30, create a Director of Juvenile Court of Programs and Resource Development at a grade 33. And he's also requesting to delete the Director of Juvenile Court Services at a grade 34 and create the Director of Juvenile Court Operations at a grade 35. The cost of this request is approximately $17,000, and this will be covered from unused budgeted indigent defense funds or part-time funds within the court.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Probably moved in second. Any questions?
Yes.
Commissioner Amber.
I'm trying to figure out what happened during our budgeting process, why this was not included.
Judge Teske.
Commissioner, the laws are recently in effect, and so it's taken some time to feel the effect of these new mandates. And so that's really the answer to the question. So they're relatively new to all of us.
I'm sorry, could you please state your name for the record?
Oh, Steve Teske, Chief Judge, Juvenile Court.
I have a question for Ms. Bivens concerning that. I know Ms. Bright said you had some money, you know, to cover it. Do you have any type of analysis on how this would impact the budget next year compared to this year when they have money left over?
We did calculate it, and what if any part-time, hold on, was it part-time money? He was gonna, we did calculate it, and it was, we were okay with it. So it won't have any future impact. If he's using part-time money, we would just take that part-time money from his part-time line and add it to his salary to cover that increase in that position, any positions.
So for both of these positions, the difference you're saying would be made up in part-time?
Yes, ma'am. Well,
positions
the,
for
I'm trying
going
to,
forward every year after
my,
that?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, they're not requesting any additional funds. They're using existing funds. So they understand that whatever existing funds they're using this year, they would give it up from here forward.
Okay.
So whatever line items they're reducing to increase that line item for the salary, they will never, ever be able to increase it without the board approving in the future.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Back to my question.
I'm sorry. I didn't
That's okay. Now, when did these mandates come down?
January 1st, 2014.
2014?
Yes, yes.
And we had our budget. When was our budget done? Well, it was effective July 1, so what happened in that time period?
Well, you know, Commissioner, in terms of juvenile justice, once the laws are changed, it takes it takes time for these things to have an impact and have an effect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so we are now, you know, beginning to feel, you know, the impact of these laws that went into effect on January 1st of 2014.
But did
I mean, they
the
don't
mandate
happen overnight.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Oppose?
Nay.
3-2, it passes. Commissioner Hamburg and Gregory oppose.
The next item is a recommendation for the Chief Operating Officer. As the board may recall, the position was advertised from June 8, 2015 to August 7th of 2015. It was advertised on the county's website, ACCG's marketplace, and through NACO in order to advertise on a nationwide basis. Two panelists were asked to interview the candidates, and those panelists were David Hankerson from Cobb County, who's the county manager there, and Terrence Moore, who's the city manager for the city of College Park. The panelists were sent 13 applications for review, and they selected five of those candidates for interviews. During the time that we scheduled the interviews, or just after the interviews had been scheduled, we had two of those five candidates withdraw. The interviews were conducted on October 9th, and based on those interviews, the panelists recommend Dietrich Stanford as the Chief Operating Officer.
Ms. Bright, how many people applied?
There were 13 applications that were sent to the...
But how many people applied?
There were about 25.
Of those 13, they were the most qualified?
Yes.
All right, is there a motion? I'll make the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Probably moved and second. Are there any questions? Hearing none. Those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
3-2, it passes. Commissioners Hambrick and Gregory opposed. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Yep. Congratulations to our new Chief Operating Officer, Dietrich Stanford. Give him a round of applause.
The board will now consider the request of Christy Barnes, Chief Staff Attorney.
Ms. Barnes, please take 2015-265 separate. Are there any other ones that board members would like to take separate?
Mr. Chairman, could we also take, 264 separately? And also, I believe some information has come forth a little while ago to hold 267 and 268 for consideration.
Yes, until after executive session.
Yeah, we amended that at the beginning of the...
I believe we want to hold them completely off the agenda. Is that right? I had heard back from Mr. Wall, Ms. Bivens, to take them off for this evening
that
altogether.
That was his recommendation that he just texted me also, because there's still some things that need to be ironed out. We thought we had them resolved, but they're not.
They're not resolved?
No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. No, that doesn't include more. That's just Lake City. So I'd like to offer that.
What numbers are those?
267 and 268 that relate to the fire and City of Lake City. This has nothing to do with Morrow and 911. Just the Lake City items.
Are you making a motion to remove them?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion to remove those from consideration this evening to be brought back once those details are worked out.
I'll second it.
All right, properly moved and second. Any other questions about it? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, it's unanimous.
Can we take, did anybody say 264 separate?
Yeah, 264 and 265.
Okay. Good evening, commissioners. First is resolution number 2015-259, which is a resolution authorizing Clayton County to amend a consultant agreement with TUSA Consulting Services, providing for the terms and conditions under which professional radio communications services will be rendered. And you should have received a revised amendment, which removes a reference to an Exhibit C. Next is resolution number 2015-260, which is a resolution authorizing Clayton County to enter into a license agreement with Sweet Serenity SSI Incorporated, providing for the terms and conditions under which a children's toy giveaway will be hosted at Clayton County International Park. This event will be December 12th, 2015. And the Director of Parks and Recreation is requesting consideration by the Board of Commissioners to approve the department's recommended fee for the event, which is a reduced facility usage fee for nonprofit entities, which was 50% of the standard cost. Resolution number 2015-261 is a resolution authorizing Clayton County to enter into an amended and restated license agreement with Diversity Talent Agency, providing for the terms and conditions under which a Labor Day weekend concert will be hosted at Clayton County International Park. And this deals with a resolution previously approved, resolution 2015-185. Resolution number 2015-262 is a resolution authorizing Clayton County to enter into a memorandum of understanding with the Georgia Public Defender Standards Council, providing for the delivery of indigent defense services under the Georgia Indigent Defense Act for fiscal year 2016. Resolution number 2015-263 is a resolution authorizing Clayton County on behalf of the Clayton County District Attorney's Office to enter into a grant award agreement with the State of Georgia Department of Human Services and, in accordance therewith, accept grant funds to be used in connection with child support recovery efforts associated with the District Attorney's Office. And these are grant funds in the amount of $683,658.20, with a local match of $13,243.24. holding 264, and we're taking it separately, and 265. Next is resolution number 2015-266, which is a resolution authorizing Clayton County to enter into a grant award agreement with the Prosecuting Attorney's Council of Georgia, and in accordance therewith, accept grant funds to be used in connection with the Victims of Crime Act and the Clayton County District Attorney's Victim Witness Assistance Program. And these are grant funds in the amount of $88,771 with a local match of $22,193.
All right, is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Properly moved and second. Any questions on any of the items?
Yes. On 259. I was checking to find out why do we have this increase of $26,000?
259.
Mr. Lavender.
Good evening, Commissioner. You might recall that in June of this year, we did acceptance testing for the radio system, and that system, of course, took a little longer than anticipated. So, but it did exceed the 95% coverage for that system guarantee. So what we have moving forward is a punch list of items that we need to clear up with the vendor before we make final payment. And that's our estimate of what it would cost to do that punch list and a final report for the radio system.
So the punch list was not included during the negotiations?
It is actually a list of items that resulted as the final reviews of the system occurred.
Payment will not exceed $13,000, correct?
26.
It's 26, I'm sorry.
We do not anticipate using that much, but that's the budget we asked for.
Okay.
To complete the punch list for those items.
But not to exceed.
Yes, ma'am.
Any other questions? All right, hearing none.
Well, I have a question on a different item.
Okay.
If you're done.
Well, I'm not. I just want to say this. I noticed on one of the presentations by Central Services, we use like the lowest bidder. And we keep doing that, and then people come back. And I believe Commissioner Rooks hit on that a couple meetings ago. And how can we avoid that? Can that be avoided?
Because
people, you know, we get the lowest bidder, and then they come back later and charge us more money. Can anybody answer that?
Commissioner Hambrick, I would venture to answer that unfortunately sometimes the scope of services that the county contemplates with vendors is not a comprehensive or a quite complete scope of services, and it necessitates additional costs or...
Well, hopefully we can work on that.
We're getting better at it anyway. Mm.
Yep.
Thank you for that.
Commissioner Adams.
This might be a Parks and Recs question. That wouldn't be you, right? Because you don't work for Parks and Recs anymore.
Right.
It's just a financial question. So we're amending the revenue agreement. So instead of an agreement that says no less than $18,000, we're going to get $5 per ticket for tickets, what? That looks to me like we're going to collect a maximum of $6,000.
So, yes, sir. It's two parts to that answer. The vendor initially, whenever they signed the contract, erroneously we provided him a contract that an initial contract said that we would do one or two things, $5 per, and if for whatever reason he didn't hit the 18,000 threshold, that we would be good, we would be made whole based upon his collection. And so when we went back and looked at the actual contract was executed, it did say the minimum would be 18,000, hence the reason why you have an amended contract coming back to the board. But in fact, the collections were right at about 11,300 is what we actually would get from the vendor.
That we're getting from the vendor, 11,000, or that we're going to get $5 per ticket on the $15 per tickets that made up the 11,000?
That's correct. So, yes.
The latter? Actually going to only make about $3,500, $4,000.
No. We didn't pay out anything. This is just the collection of the $5 per $15 ticket sold, which came to the 11,300.
Okay. So...
that covers our costs. And what I'm getting at is, so we took the park for all of Labor Day weekend. The promoter didn't have good sales. So are we going to revisit this vendor in this promoter in the future, or were we giving up opportunities with other promoters, and now we're getting a much more discounted amount from this? Just trying to understand how this actually affects us and might affect us going forward.
So revenue, of all our actual holiday dates for the park, Labor Day is probably our least, visited time. And so the initial discussion was to have $18,000 in, because we figured when we look at our revenue over the last 5 or 6 years, we probably, through the 3 days, probably collected right at $18,000, hence the reason why that was part of the initial discussion. So as far as revenue loss, really wasn't any revenue loss. We still would have had the staff there with the lifeguarding, as well as the ticket sales for the ticket takers for the beach, and we had to pay that salary either way. So if you look at a true loss based upon historically how we spent funds, we probably would have done $18,000 as we've done in the past based upon the trends, then we probably would have lost right about $5,000, $6,000.
Or we might have gotten more tickets sold if we just charged a typical $5 versus their premium. That might have turned business away.
Certainly. So part of the debriefing with this vendor is that one of two things is that we either need to have a guaranteed threshold for which we ensure that we eclipse that threshold, or we don't do business with this vendor moving forward as it relates to the Labor Day timeline.
Okay. Thank you for the clarification and explanation. I don't have any other questions.
Any other questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous.
Next is resolution number 2015-264. Which is a resolution authorizing Clayton County to enter into an intergovernmental agreement with the City of Morrow for the provision of emergency communications services, or E911 services. And you should have received a revised resolution, which has been revised to reflect on the second page, section one, that the county's ability to enter into the intergovernmental agreement with Morrow is contingent upon the county's receipt of written notice that the agreement between Morrow and Lake City for fire, emergency medical services, and 911 emergency communication services, that agreement has been terminated. And the accompanying intergovernmental agreement has also been revised from the document that you may have to reflect changes to the compensation and fees, which is paragraph 4.
All right. I also like to point out at this time that Mayor J.B. Burke and Sylvia Riddick, and I believe I see Ms. Han Tran in the back, are here, and I appreciate y'all being here this evening. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second? Second it, probably moving second. Any questions?
I have two questions. I'm not sure if these are legal, finance, or fire, or 911. But on item 4, Ms. Barnes, mm-hmm. under the compensation, maybe I'm reading more into this than necessary, but the last sentence in that paragraph regarding compensation and fees says, in addition to any 911 service fees contemplated under Georgia law, Morrow also agrees to remit to the county an additional $100,000 annually for personnel and operational expenses to the county's E91 Communications Center. Now, it seems to me like the last half of that sentence might be considered being omitted and just putting a period after annually. Are we saying that we're going to increase service specifically to that department by $100,000 a year, or would we be supplanting other revenues to fund the existing or expanded services of that department? And if for some reason the amount of services necessary in that department to provide an adequate amount of service to the city of Morrow doesn't cost $100,000, are we not allowed to use that money for anything else?
So, yes.
You got that, Jack?
No,
I've
got something else. Excuse me.
Oh, sorry.
So, Commissioner.
You look like you had the answer on the tip of your tongue. Sorry.
So yes, the $100,000 that we negotiated with the city of Morrow, $100,000 could be utilized, and we specified it as personnel costs or operational costs for the E911 facility.
Okay, so that means additional, we can supplant existing costs and move other funding sources to general fund, or is it up to 100? Are we gonna have to, what if we only spend $99,000?
Are you referring to supplanting the budgeted funds that's already in
sure,
E911?
Sure, yeah.
Yes, sir, we have that as an option.
We're allowed to do that? I always heard supplanting is a bad word. I don't have a problem with the concept or the dollar amount. It just seems like it's a little too detailed. That, like I said, the last half of that sentence doesn't seem to be particularly necessary to me. If it said, in addition to the service fees, et cetera, an additional $100,000 annually, period, it seems to me like it would be cleaner and there wouldn't be any potential future problems.
So are you recommending that we strike that from the...
Well, I guess I'm looking for some insight from those of y'all that negotiated this contract. It seems to me like that would be a prudent recommendation,
the spirit,
but I don't know.
Yeah. So the spirit of the $100,000, again, as I talked with the city manager, with Ms. Reddick, the idea was that she wanted to ensure what would the $100,000 be used for.
Sure. And
so we tried to provide some language to kind of outline the purpose of the $100,000.
And I'm fine with the spirit of that. What I'm saying is, as it's worded, are we limiting the use or interpretation of the use? Ms. Bivens, I'm looking for some help here.
Commissioner Emerson, the E911 fund, those funds can only be used in the E911 center for the operations, which includes personnel, operating costs. Any excess funds would go into a reserve. They would have a fund balance.
Okay, so E91 fund have to be used for E911, but this is an additional $100,000 pursuant to an IGA, so categorically this doesn't qualify as E911 funds.
Well, if the purpose of it is for E911 communications, we would have to set it up as a special project.
I'm not trying to spend it elsewhere. I'm just trying to understand it is all. So the intent, the way this is written, is this would go into the E911 fund along with other E91 funds to be used for E911, and would just carry forward if we don't use it.
That is correct.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you for that clarification. The second question I have is under item 6. It says, and that might have sounded like double top, but I understand it. Under number 6, it says, about halfway through the paragraph, it says, the dispatching and management of all emergency calls forwarded to Morrow shall be the responsibility of the Clayton County Communications Department. I'm trying to understand that. Okay, so if we're forwarding them, the dispatching, and where does the responsibility end, right? If we're forwarding a call to Morrow because we're handling 911, this would suggest to me that we're also supposed to be dispatching and managing that emergency call, because it says dispatch and management of all emergency calls. So the definition of an emergency call means the actual management of the call, or just or the activities on the ground?
No, the police department handles the activities that are on ground. The dispatch receives the call, dispatches it to the officer, provides pertinent information related to that incident. And then once the officers get on scene, then usually, unless there's additional information, then they pull back.
So that's when the call ends. The call ends
when... Well, don't necessarily end, because they might need to check a tag or something like that, so they still stay in communication. But the management of that incident is incumbent upon the people, the officers on scene.
Okay, and again, this might just be clarification for me. So emergency call is not defined as the actual whole experience. The officer or fire or whomever going on site and handling the call, as they call it, until it's done.
They have incident command,
okay. On ground. And that's different than emergency call. Okay, thank you for that clarification. Those are the only questions I had.
I have a question.
I have a question.
Oh.
Lost SDS.
Exactly.
So how do we determine the amount that was delineated for Morrow under the SDS?
I think the amount is gonna be an amount. You're talking about the distribution of revenues.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's something that would be reflected in the lost certificate. which is related, of course, to the service delivery strategy, but those actual tax revenues are broken out in the loss certificate, and I believe we will have to revise the loss distribution amounts to reflect that the county will now be providing Morrow with this service.
Do we not need to have that in the resolution?
I can't find it. I believe there is a provision that states
couldn't find it.
That the county,
I didn't see it.
That you are correct, Madam Commissioner. It doesn't contain any language regarding how the loss distribution will be handled in the future. We can certainly include in the intergovernmental agreement that nothing in this agreement would preclude the parties from taking the fact that the county is going to provide this service tomorrow into consideration when we are negotiating the loss distribution amounts.
So do we need to go back and renegotiate that before we vote on it?
I think so. I would say yes.
Renegotiate the lost?
The wording. We need to have some wording in the contract that says that.
Well, we have representatives from Morrow here. Ms. Riddick and Mayor, if you could come up, please.
Well, hang on. Maybe just kind of conceptually. This is an IGA that's independent of loss distributions. Is that right?
Yes.
So what language may or may not be relevant to the loss shouldn't matter to this. This is completely independent of that.
Well, wouldn't it? Yeah, thank you.
Well, because that's this document on a shelf over there with a certain funding mechanism. This is going to be a document over here on a shelf with a different funding mechanism, and they don't overlap.
Okay, well, explain that to me. I get most things that I don't get.
Commissioner Rooks, if I may.
On the mic.
Please take the mic.
And if you could, please, if you'll just restate your name for me, please.
Laren Barnes, and I represent Morrow in this matter in the negotiations. That have begun with the county on this matter. So there is not a negotiation on the loss being amended to reflect Clayton County providing this service tomorrow. As Commissioner Edmondson has said, those are two separate. The $100,000 that's reflected, I believe, in paragraph 4 is the compensation that you
I got
guys
it. Mm-hmm.
are asking for. So the loss there wouldn't be an additional compensation out of the loss. That's what you may have done when you negotiated E911 with the other two cities that you serve, but here it would be a totally separate agreement which is reflected in the $100,000.
So we are not getting, so next year when the revenue starts to flow in and we decide how much each city gets based on the services that you deliver, since you will no longer deliver E911 services, correct?
That's correct.
Are you going to get funding for E911 services?
Your question is a little convoluted because E911 fees, mm-hmm. right, would come directly to the county if this was executed.
Okay, so let me just plain language. From the revenue that we get from loss, do you guys as a municipality receive
that? Won't change. It wouldn't change.
So you will still get it?
Mm-hmm. We would still get our portion of the loss, and you would get, for providing the service, if we go forward with this IGA, the $100,000 in addition to the 911.
How much do you guys get from the lost funds for E911?
It's not broken out like that.
There's nothing that says.
No, ma'am.
Police services, fire mm-hmm. services.
No. You're talking about a formula that is definitely over my mathematical skills, okay? So you're talking about a formula that it's almost as if the county's in one column, the city is in another column. What do you provide? Check, check, check.
Absolutely.
Check, check, versus what does the city provide?
Right.
Well,
and then the calculation is done. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just saying, the only person I see in this room is Jack, and I know he's in the middle of something, but when we went through line by line and we enumerated those services in the SDS and the dollar amounts of those services, E911 wasn't part of it.
Okay, no, that's
because it has a separate funding mechanism.
Well, she said it was.
But
is it
it's
not
in the SDS?
But it doesn't have a funding amount because it's separately funded.
Because it has. You're right. It's the 911 fees.
Okay,
right.
That's all I need to know. That was.
And we would get those.
That's what I was asking. When the funds are distributed, is there a number for E911? You're saying there's not.
That's correct.
Okay.
So is everybody good with that? The explanation. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Mayor Burke.
First thing is, I want to apologize to the commissioners and the chairman about the last meeting. I did not know it was a meeting for discussion, and I'm not pleading ignorance. I'm just telling you I apologize about that, and I would have been here. The second thing is, thank you for the questions that you've asked. They were very legal, and for allowing council to answer them. I could not do that, so I appreciate that as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayor. All right, any other questions? All right.
Were you going to say something?
In consultation, with Chief Murkison and with Mr. Fincher, who represents Lake City, we've got a small problem with what you've done at this point in time, because by taking Lake City's off the table tonight, we've created a situation where if you were to approve this resolution, that requires that before it goes into effect, MARA terminate their entire agreement with Lake City, which includes 911, fire, and EMS, then we could leave Lake City in the lurch with no service at all in order for MARA to be able to get the 911 service that they need from the county. So my suggestion would be that you modify this slightly to provide that it goes into effect only upon the termination of the E911 component of the MARA Lake City agreement, and that you agree to pick up the Lake City E911 for their fees if that happens, just so we don't leave them completely without E911 service. That's the issue, and right. So
would it be better to hold this, them all at the same time?
Let's hold it.
We're only talking like next meeting.
That's what I say, just hold it. It's too
much
going on.
That's the problem, and I didn't want you to leave them in a crack.
Yeah. I say let's just hold it.
Yeah.
I mean, if you think we can amend this to say effective upon the termination of the 911 component of the Morrow Lake City, and that we will pick it up, it seems like that's an awful lot of language for a small thing, for a small window of time. Mayor, I'm not suggesting that this has got problems. It's just that if this other one's got some funding detail language that's going to come back, just couldn't get it done tonight. It's going to come back at the very next board meeting, which I anticipate it will.
Well, I think you're right. A lot of, when you come up here.
Please speak into the mic, Mayor.
A yes or no answer, and then certain things come up, derivatives come up, and I certainly agree. And you meet again in 2 weeks, and it'll have time for everyone to work everything out. I personally think it's a good suggestion, and the
Mr. Hancock? Okay.
It's not.
A good suggestion that Mr. Hancock made about, to get one eliminated, because we understand about the agreement with Lake City. So I'm just not in disagreement. I think your suggestion is a good one, and I think this
well, however y'all want to do it, then. Okay, thank you.
Okay, is there a different motion on the table?
Well, Mr. Chairman, if no one else wants to, I'll make a motion that we hold Resolution 2015-264.
Second.
And bring it back in conjunction with 267 and 268.
Second.
Probably moving to second. Any questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed. It's unanimous.
Who is working on this in this office? Is it you, Diedrich? Because I'd like to get a better understanding before we bring it back. Okay. All right. Thank you. We have some time to talk about it. Okay.
All right, Ms. Barnes.
Last is resolution number 2015-265, which is a resolution to reappoint Gregory Porter as the permanent chief of the Clayton County Police Department, to combine the 911 Communications Center Department with the Clayton County Police Department, to authorize the chairman to perform any acts necessary to accomplish the intent of this resolution, to authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget as needed to reflect an appropriate revenue source and expense, to authorize an effective date of this resolution, and for other purposes.
Is there a motion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that we reappoint Mr. Greg Porter as chief of police for Clayton County.
Is there a second?
Mr. Chair, I second that motion.
Any questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Those opposed?
Nay.
3-2, it fails.
Yes, sir. And Mr. Chairman, I need an executive session for real estate, litigation, and personnel.
Okay, and before we adjourn.
Commissioner Hamrick.
Yes, I would like to thank the Clayton County Parks and Recreation, my staff, Tina Howard, and Mara Singletary as the volunteer. Also, Troy Hodges, Troy Stubbs, Coach Shockley.
Please, let's take our conversations outside. Commissioners, make the statement. Go ahead, Commissioner.
This past Saturday, we had the Clayton County Parks and Recreation Fall Festival at Flat Shows Park. And I would like to thank all those involved because it was a very big success. And some of those people were my constituent aide, Tina Howard, a volunteer, Mara Singletary, Troy Hodges, Troy Stubbs, Coach Shockley, Ralph Turner, and all the parks and rec people that participated. It was a very big success. And a special thanks to Captain Tina Daniel. Really wanted to give her a big hand. She just came back from sick leave and did a tremendous job. We have really missed her in our district. I've been getting calls from other communities, well, the communities in my district, saying how glad they are that she's back. Before we had an activity in the park and traffic and everything was just all discombobulated. But this time, with the help of Captain Daniel, everything flowed very smoothly. She was all over the place. I asked Captain A, which is her husband, I call him Captain A and Captain T, thanks, for helping to get her back so she could come back and help us, because District 2 really does need Captain Daniel. So I just want to say that, and a big thanks to her and to Parks and Recreation. Thank you, Troy.
And now
I'm sorry, and Dietrich, in his role as Parks and Rec at the time.
Anybody else?
Let's see. And for you, for updoing the nay-nay.
Hey, you're doing too much.
And you know what? And we missed the TV 23 that really should have been there, because there was some good filming that could have been done for that. And we omitted. Where's the fire chief? They get a chance at the next meeting to give us their version of the nay-nay.
Okay. All right.
As long as you're doing it too, Commissioner Hambridge.
Oh, I was.
She did it.
That's
why
I say TV 23 should have been there. I took lead.
She was doing the stanky leg too. So. All right, and I see now that Ms. Barnes has moved, that Councilwoman Bridges is here. Also, thank you for being here. Of course, our illustrious Mayor Willie Oswalt and his city council is here.
Councilwoman Hang Tran.
I already said
you
yeah.
Say Hang Tran?
Mm-hmm. You weren't
paying
attention.
I didn't hear it. I'm sorry.
Joel, appreciate you being here. So thank y'all for representing this time out. Is there a motion to go into executive session?
Wait.
Strike that. I was getting ahead of myself.
Yeah.
All right, so next.
Mr. Chairman, item number 21 is an appointment to the Department of Behavioral Health and Development and Disabilities Region 3 Advisory Council to fill a vacant seat formerly held by Mr. Brent Benedetti. The term is for 3 years, expiring on April 2nd, 2016. This is a full board appointment. Are there any nominations?
Board's hard to fill.
They are.
Hearing none.
Honey, we need to get somebody this.
Hearing none. We do have one zoning petition. This is the Clayton North Bridge LLC. The request is for a modification to a condition of a zoning and the North Bridge Estate Subdivision Unit 5. The applicant's request is to modify a condition from 33% of units with one car garage side entry to 9% of units with two car garage side entry. This is District 3. This is Commissioner Rook's district. The Zoning Advisory Group has recommended approval. Is the applicant present?
I believe that's him running down the aisle.
Do we have any opposition to this zoning request?
Please take the podium, sir. Any opposition? Anybody here in opposition? Okay, sir.
Good evening, Chairman, members of the board. I apologize. I was trying to get a drink of water real quick. My name is Steve Moore. I'm with Moorbass Consulting, 1350 Keys Ferry Court, McDonough, Georgia, representing Clayton Northbridge LLC, who is the applicant in this request. We've got 109 lots in an existing subdivision called Northbridge Estates Unit 5. That subdivision, gotta catch my breath. I was sprinting. And for me, it's, you know, takes it all out of you. Our request is to modify a condition that was approved with the final plat, that is a requirement for 33% of the homes in the subdivision have side entry garages. This request was presented actually in January of this year and made it to the zoning advisory group. And at that hearing, we had a good amount of opposition from the neighbors in that subdivision with concerns about our request. As a product of that meeting, we chose to withdraw our application so that we could have an opportunity to meet with the Homeowners Association and their representatives to discuss our proposal and see if we could, you know, get their support and come up with an amicable solution for this project. Happy to report that I think we do have that agreement in place. But I will, if it's okay, just give a brief history of kind of how we got where we are. And I've got a couple of exhibits I'd like to hand to you, and if I don't run out of breath on the way up there to... So again, Unit 5 means there are four phases that preceded this project. Those four phases were all developed with much larger lots than what you see. The exhibit you have, the two lots on the left is what was approved in Units 1 through 4. The two lots on the right is what was approved as part of Unit 5. Unit 5 was approved as a conservation subdivision, meaning that you have smaller lots with a greater amount of open space. And that's exactly how it was platted. The condition for side entry garages makes it very challenging when you have lots that are as small as were platted in Unit 5. Typically, a side entry garage works on a lot that's about minimum of 90 feet wide, preferably probably 100 feet wide. Lots in Unit 5 are 70 feet wide. So basically our request is to modify that condition to the 9%, which basically equates to all of the lots that are on corners, corner streets, which are the lots that can easily accommodate a side entry garage. The others would require a much smaller footprint in order to be able to accommodate the swing of a driveway, making a left turn or a right turn into a side entry garage. And so our request essentially is to request that variance so that we can build larger houses that would have a front entry garage, and then the side entry garages on the corner lots that could easily accommodate those. Hopefully that exhibit kind of explains that. We understand staff's recommended approval. We know that zoning advisory group approved it, and again, we have an agreement with the Homeowner Association and have their endorsement with this request, and respectfully request your approval as well, and I'm here to answer any questions you've got.
Okay. Thank you for that. Again, I'm gonna ask, is there anyone here in opposition to this? Okay, are there any questions?
Sir, what's your name again?
My name is Steve Moore.
Mr. Moore, I will say for the record, we have been dealing with this since January.
Yes, ma'am.
And this is a result of when the Homeowners Association gets involved.
That's right.
And they really, really did pressure you guys to make some adjustments for them.
Most definitely.
So I commend them for their involvement.
Yes, ma'am.
And even after seeing this, I emailed and I said, are we sure? Are we okay? And I got the go ahead. So
yes, ma'am.
My recommendation would be to accept the recommendation from zoning.
Okay.
And I will second that. Are there any other questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed, it's unanimous.
Thank you. Sorry for the...
You're good.
Mr. Chairman, this does conclude tonight's agenda.
We did have a request to go into executive session for real estate, litigation, and personnel.
It's a motion to go into the executive session.
So moved.
Is there a second? I'll second it. Properly moved and second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.